Anyone who has watched a president who isn't dyeing their hair through their term in office knows stress might be a cause for gray hair. If you have teenagers, you've probably even remarked to them that the stress they cause is making you turn gray, all the while not fully appreciating the fact that you have hair in the first place. In any event, the truth is that going gray really has to do with the production of pigment in your hair follicles. That production process can be altered by several contributing factors, stress being one of them. To understand what makes our hair turn gray, we need to first talk about what makes our hair grow and what gives it color. A person's hair color is the result of pigments known as melanin. Made from two amino acids, tyrosine and phenylalanine, these pigments are produced by a specialized group of cells known as melanocytes. They do this through a process called melanogenesis. Melanocytes are found throughout our body, and the melanin they produce is what gives our skin, hair, and eyes their color. The melanocytes responsible for hair color are found in the bulbs of your hair follicles. Even though there is a wide range of hair and skin color, there are only two main types of melanin: eumelanin, which produces dark browns and blacks, and pheomelanin, which produces reddish yellow. How these cells blend together will determine what color your hair will be. It isn't fully known what makes the melanocytes blend together in the ways they do to make the specific hair color for each individual. What is known is that there appear to be clear genetic factors. One gene and its alleles responsible for red hair have already been identified. Known as MC1R, this is also the same gene responsible for red pigments in several other species, like cows. Once the specific formulation of melanin is produced, their granules are transferred to adjacent keratinocytes, also found in the bulbs of your hair follicles. Keratinocytes are what produce keratin, the dead protein cells that make up our hair. Once a keratinocyte undergoes its scheduled death, it retains the melanin, making our hair color what it is. The less melanin, the more gray your hair will be. White hair has no melanin at all. There are a few different processes that can make our hair turn gray. The one most people think of is the natural graying that occurs as we grow older. As we age, our melanocytes become inactive but are still present. The older we get, melanocytes decrease in number. The result is less and less melanin until none is present at all. Thus, we slowly turn gray and then our hair turns white in the winter of our lives. In February of 2005, Harvard scientists proposed a theory as to why melanocytes decrease as we age. They found that a failure of melanocyte stem cells was the cause. These stem cells stop producing adequate numbers of melanocytes to maintain our color. In 2009, scientists in Europe found another contributing factor. They found that hair follicles produce small amounts of hydrogen peroxide. As any teenager preparing for a concert will know, if you expose your hair to hydrogen peroxide, it will make your hair lighter. Normally, the small amount of hydrogen peroxide is broken down by an enzyme called catalase. As we age, catalase production is reduced. The result is a buildup of hydrogen peroxide, which blocks melanin production by melanocytes. There are several other things that can cause our hair to turn gray. The exact mediating factor of them isn't fully known. Some include genetic defects, abnormal hormone production, like in the case of sudden or chronic stress, abnormal body distribution of melanin, and climate factors can also cause graying, such as pollutants, toxins, and chemical exposure. As for stress, in 2011, the 2012 Nobel Prize winner in chemistry, Robert Lefkowitz, led a research group that discovered the mechanism that could explain why stress causes graying. Stress causes a release of numerous neurotransmitters involved in our fight or flight response. Normally, the release of these neurotransmitters is short-lived and has very beneficial attributes, the ability to run from a chasing lion or avoid an oncoming car, to name a couple. Long-term production of these neurotransmitters, however, can cause DNA damage. This damage was shown by this group to promote aging, the growth of tumors, miscarriages, psychiatric conditions, and the graying of hair. The time and speed at which you will gray varies greatly. It's determined by many, if not all, the factors that we've discussed here, such as your genetic predisposition, chemical exposures, and the levels of chronic stress throughout your life, to name a few. And now for a bonus fact. The average scalp has 100 to 150,000 hairs. Hair is so strong that if you made all of your hair into a rope, it could hold 10 to 15 tons, or about 3.5 ounces per strand. Hair also has the highest rate of cell division in the body. It grows 0.3 millimeters per day on average and 1 centimeter per month. Thankfully, each hair has its own life cycle. If it didn't, instead of losing hair randomly, we would molt. On that note, hair grows in three phases. Anagen, the active growth stage, 80 to 85% of your hair is currently in this phase. Catagen, this phase is also known as the transitional phase, when hair begins to stop growing. And telogen, this phase is when your hair is completely shut down and the fibers fall out. 10 to 15% of our hair is in this phase at any given time. After your hair goes through the telogen phase, anagen begins again, and voila, more hair for some people. As you might have guessed from this, hair length is completely controlled by the length of the anagen phase of your hair follicle. How long this period lasts is generally determined mostly by genetics, but can also be affected by hormones and even extreme stress, which in some cases can cause the majority of hair on your body to rapidly transition to the telogen phase and fall out. As to how, there is some chemical signal that ultimately controls the exact growth cycle. However, it isn't yet fully known what exactly triggers the catagen phase beyond that. But once it is triggered, the outer part of the root ends up being cut off from its nutrient supply, that's blood, as well as the cells that produce new hair, thus your hair stops growing. This phase lasts about 3 weeks. As mentioned, next up comes the telogen phase, where the follicle is in a resting state and your hair is now a club hair, completely dead down to the root. During this stage, the hairs can relatively easily be pulled out, as can happen when brushing, combing, and washing your hair. But if they manage to last long enough, they'll eventually be pushed out again by a new hair as the cycle begins again. Obviously, hairs on your arms and legs have a very different anagen period than hairs on your head, thus why your leg hair doesn't grow to be 2 feet long without trimming. Further, different people, thanks mostly to their genetics, have differing lengths of the anagen period for a given body part compared to other people. For the hair on your head, the average length of the anagen phase is about 2 to 7 years. For your arms, legs, eyebrows, etc., this phase is usually just 30 to 45 days. However, in extreme cases, which are quite rare, some people have anagen periods for their heads as small as most people's anagen phases for their arms and legs. For these people, their hair never naturally grows more than a few inches long. The opposite is also true with people whose anagen phase can last decades for their scalp hair. Under normal circumstances, though, you can get a rough estimate of how long your anagen phase is based on how long your hair grows naturally without cutting a given area. First, assuming your hair isn't already as long as it can get, measure your hair length, then exactly a month later, measure it again and note the difference. Now you have your hair growth rate, usually about 1 centimeter every 28 days or 1 inch every 71 days. So if without cutting, the hair in your head eventually grows to 16 inches long max, then your anagen phase lasts inches multiplied by period per inch. So using the average of 1 inch every 71 days, 16 inches by 71 days per inch, which is approximately 1,136 days, or 3.11 years. As you might have now guessed, with the fact that hair growth is completely controlled by what's going on under the surface within your hair follicles, and that genetics and hormones are the primary things determining hair growth length, which are in no way affected by shaving, contrary to popular belief, shaving does not in any way alter your hair growth rate, nor does it alter the color of your hair. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Also, if you're looking for something more from me, why not check out our podcast? It's called The Brain Food Show. If you search Brain Food, one word, wherever you get your podcasts, you will find it. It's sort of like this show, just a little bit more laid back. Like I say, find it wherever you get your podcasts. And as always, thank you for watching.